Hello, I'm Dr. Tom Green, and today we'll be talking about common sense strategies for avoiding pest problems, specifically for housekeeping and maintenance professionals working in healthcare facilities. This webinar is part of the healthcare facilities project with the Maryland Pesticide Education Network. And our goal in the project is to promote defined integrated pest management to reduce pesticide use and impacts in Maryland healthcare facilities to protect high-risk populations. We've been working with healthcare facilities in the Maryland area since 2006, and the project provides pro bono consultation and educational services to healthcare facilities. So working with our partner facilities, we've conducted initial, very detailed walkthroughs of facilities and provided a free report with the findings and recommendations to prevent pest problems. We also provide a bi-monthly newsletter and your pest management contractor log report reviews, and then consultation as you face challenging pest and land care issues going forward. So we work with hospitals because hospitals have vulnerable groups, infants and children, pregnant women, the elderly, people with compromised immune and nervous systems, and those with asthma and other respiratory problems, as well as cancer patients and others who are sensitive to chemicals. So what do we mean by a defined IPM approach? Well, IPM is a systems approach to pest management. It's a strategy that provides long-term prevention of pest problems, and it includes regular monitoring of pests, inspecting sites regularly, education, and we'll hear about that, the importance of educating staff and others in healthcare facilities, and a range of controls to manage pests, and we'll get into that in detail. And really our focus is on why is the pest there and what can we do to resolve that issue rather than just treating symptoms with pesticides. So pest management is really important and many people don't realize how important it is. So mouse droppings are much more than a nuisance. They're a sign that you're being exposed potentially to health risks. Exposure to cockroaches, dust mites, mice, mold, and some pollens can trigger asthma and can cause asthma with long-term exposure to those kinds of conditions. Rodents and birds and insects also carry disease and can cause some serious food safety risks as they're contacting food and food preparation services. Surfaces in food service areas. Rodents are also responsible for fires. They chew on wires and can cause short circuits. And they have tremendous reproductive capacity. So really important that we don't let them get started. Some pests vector disease, and certainly we've heard about tick-borne diseases and mosquito-borne diseases in the news lately. Tick-borne diseases are spreading and we're having more diseases show up in the US and same thing with mosquitoes. And we can do a lot to manage our habitat around our healthcare facilities and inside our healthcare facilities to avoid these problems. I remember once working with a facility and they were having mosquitoes inside their front entryway. And we took a look. They had fountains outside. One of them wasn't functioning, and that was allowing mosquitoes to breed in there and then head right in the front door. So things like that can be addressed long-term rather than treating those mosquitoes with pesticides. We just got that fountain working and mosquitoes were no longer breeding. So that's a good example. And then of course we have stinging insects, and that can be very important in healthcare facilities. There have been many instances where people have been bitten inside facilities, and because they're not ambulatory, they may not even be conscious. They're not able to respond and report these issues. And that's particularly important when we have people with allergies to insect venom who can have a serious life-threatening reaction to the venom. Pests also cause building and grounds damage. Just this morning, I was called out for a squirrel issue, and the squirrel was up in the eaves of the house and chewing a hole through the soffit to make a home for the winter. So days are getting shorter now, and this industrious squirrel was getting prepared for next winter by chewing a hole into the house. And then, of course, if you let squirrels, other animals, damage your facility and continue to live in there, costs can go way up if you have a serious bat infestation, for example, and that doesn't get resolved quickly. You can end up having to take out entire walls to remove the bat droppings and dead bats. And then, of course, lawsuits can occur as a result of a pest injury to patients, and healthcare facilities have had their food service shut down because of infestation with mice or cockroaches, for example. So IPM can go a long way to saving you big dollars that can result from pest disasters. We're also concerned about pesticide risk generally, and especially in healthcare facilities. So when we talk about risks from pesticides, we have acute effects, which happens shortly after an exposure, and then we have chronic effects that can occur long after exposure, and particularly repeated exposure to pesticides, and then sometimes delayed effects that occur after a day, and sometimes a result of multiple exposures. So multiple concerns with pesticides, particularly if they're used by untrained people and inappropriate uses. And we've seen that happen in healthcare facilities where staff may be allowed to bring in pesticides from home or from a local hardware store to deal with an issue. And with IPM, as I mentioned, we want to solve those problems long-term and certainly not have staff resorting to use pesticides on their own because they're frustrated with ongoing persistent pest problems that are not being resolved. So acute effects, those are those things that happen within 24 hours. When there's an exposure, can include headache, tiredness, nausea, diarrhea, convulsions, inability to breathe, and unconsciousness. Those chronic effects, which don't happen for a while and can be really tough to nail down what the affected person was exposed to, can include this list of issues from birth defects to developmental disorders. Delayed effects can include memory loss, tumors, and cancer. So all reasons why we want to minimize use of pesticides and exposure to pesticides. So you, as a housekeeping and maintenance professional, working in any type of facility, are really the first line of defense against pests. You're so important. You regularly see every part of the facility and work with everyone in the facility. And because pests need food, water, and shelter, if you can eliminate access to those, pests disappear, you have the power to do that in many cases, just doing what you're doing currently in your role. So your facility manager is typically responsible for pest management in the facility and oversees any contractor that you have providing pest management services. And you can play a very important role by reporting pest sightings and also pest-friendly conditions. And typically a healthcare facility will have a work order system And many times housekeeping and maintenance professionals have access to that and can report issues that they can't address right away so that the appropriate people can come along and take action and fix those deficiencies. So let's get into some of the pests that we encounter in healthcare facilities. And indoors, those include insects like ants, cockroaches, flies, spiders as well, mice and rats, termites, carpenter ants are one type of ants that we see that damage wood. Bed bugs, of course, have been an important issue over the past 10 years or so. And head lice, you certainly can experience a head lice issue on a patient in a hospital that needs to be addressed. Outdoors, we have weeds, certainly, but we also have birds. Birds can also carry disease. They're often up on the roof of the building where maybe maintenance people are the only professionals that get up there and see what's going on there. They may be nesting around HVAC equipment with potential for pathogens to be brought in through the air conditioning or heating system. Then we've got a wide range of small mammals. Squirrels, chipmunks can cause problems to the exterior of buildings. Snakes, all sorts of plant diseases and insects, and then stinging insects as well. We want to be checking, particularly outside of our entranceways, to make sure that there aren't paper wasp nests or mud dauber wasps, for example. So some of these pests are nuisances and some of them are real health risks, as we talked about. So when we're doing our jobs, cleaning, fixing, repairing, renovating, things that we want to be looking out for are evidence of pest presence. So these might be live or dead pests, a mouse carcass, for example, or a mouse in a trap that the pest management contractor has left. They can include droppings. You know, so here we see some mouse droppings, rodent hair, cast molts. So insects, when they grow out of their skin and they leave their old skin behind. And so you might find cast skins from insects. Grease marks. So rodents have oil on their fur. And when they're using a hole to get in and out of a facility or to move around within a facility, some of that oil rubs off, and so you'll see some grease marks or gray marking around a hole. That's a good indicator of rodent use. And then, of course, nests, termite tubes, carpenter ant galleries, and so forth are other signs of pests. And sometimes it's damage, a hole in the soffit, like I saw this morning that the squirrel was creating. So it helps to get educated about some basics, and often we'll go into a facility and people will say, oh, we've got rats here. And they don't have rats, they have mice. And we can tell by the size of the droppings. Rat droppings are much larger than mouse droppings. And we can even tell whether it's a roof rat or a Norway rat based on the droppings. These are Norway rat droppings here. And roof rats tend to have very tapered ends to them. And as we learn more, we can learn interesting facts. So sometimes people will confuse cockroach droppings, American cockroach droppings, with mouse droppings. And sometimes they can be about the same size. But mouse droppings have tapered ends and cockroach droppings have squared off ends. And that's because mice and rats are mammals and they have a sphincter just like us, whereas cockroaches don't. And so they don't have those tapered ends. So we also have two-legged pests in healthcare facilities, and those are called clutter bugs. And most facilities have at least one. And it may be you. Sometimes we go into a custodial closet and it's just cram-packed and impossible to completely clean or do a good inspection. Or we might go into the staff lounge and find that kind of condition, or into mechanical rooms where maintenance people have stashed supplies that they might need sometime in the future as a way to save the facility money. But in the long run, it can cost you if you can't inspect and you end up with a home for pests and end up with pest problems. One of the things I like to say is that if you're going out in the woods, you know, where would you look for insects, for example? Well, the common answer is, well, I, you know, turn over logs or turn over rocks. And what we're doing in these situations, these clutter situations, is filling up a room with logs and rocks. And it makes ideal habitat for things like house centipedes or earwigs or silverfish or mice. So really important that if we have someone in the facility with clutter issues, that gets addressed. And it makes your job easier. You know, what are you going to do if you have to get in here and clean if there's a spill, or you have to get in here to fix something? Makes your job impossible. Okay, so what can you do in your roles as housekeeping and maintenance professionals? Well, certainly report any signs of pests, so any sightings of pests, any pest damage, droppings, chewing, those sorts of things, so that they can get addressed. The facility manager can evaluate what needs to happen and who needs to be called to do what. Here's rodent-friendly conditions in a trash handling area and in a mechanical room. Trash handling areas are so important to keep clean because they just provide a tremendous food resource for pests. Resolving maintenance issues promptly. So what happens when we end up with moisture damage like this? You know, you can take down a tile like that and there may be a mold growth on the other side that may be causing allergy issues for someone. That hole up in that suspended ceiling there really needs to get fixed and not left. It can be a disaster if mice get up in those suspended ceilings. You end up with a load of droppings and urine in the ceiling, and you have to call in people with hazmat capability to clean that out, and the whole ceiling needs to get replaced. So really important not to leave any openings that mice might use to get into a ceiling. And really important there to realize that mice need only a quarter inch, so the size of your little finger, to get in. And rats need about the size of your thumb to get in. So really important to close up those small openings. Preventing harborages. So often storage space is at a premium, and we see things happening like the storage on the milk crates or storage on bread racks. Good idea to keep things off the floor, but when you don't have clearance like you do on that shelf in the upper right under the floor, you can't get a broom in there to sweep, and you can't see what's going on under there. So often we find mice setting up nests in those milk crates. Upholstered furniture, not ideal in healthcare or other facilities because of the potential for rodents to live in there. And then of course you have people sitting and eating on those and crumbs falling in. And so you're giving rodents a great house to live in and a regular food source. So that rack on the left is really what you need. It's got slots in it, you know, much like the wire rack on the right has openings. So things that spill, drop to the floor, making it easy to clean up and giving you plenty of clearance to inspect under there, whether you're a housekeeping staff or a pest management contractor coming in, and plenty of room to clean under there. So we talked about the tiny holes that mice can squeeze through and rats can squeeze through, and we often find those in facilities. So here on the left, you see that rotating doorway, and the door seal is torn in the door on the right, and that's plenty of room for rats to enter. Overhead doors, you see on the right there, there's a big gap there that needs to be sealed. That gap in the ceiling up at the top. Down below, we're creating great habitat, providing a good food source, and pests, rodents, getting into that situation there. Then they have cover to work on getting into the facility further. So that squirrel that was getting into the soffit this morning, if we let that squirrel live in that soffit, he's going to be curious. He's going to feel the warmth coming out of that wall. And next thing you know, this winter, that squirrel will be chewing through that wall and be into the house. So we have a picture of a floor drain here. And what's that got to do with access? Well, rodents, cockroaches can use that drain for access into the facility from the sewer, where they may be picking up all sorts of pathogens. So we need to consider that an access point, and we don't want to be modifying the grate. So here we have sections of the grate cut out, and that leaves plenty of room for rats to come through. The reason we have grates on there is to allow water to exit and to keep rodents from entering. Drains are really important as a food source as well. So you can see this drain in the lower picture has organic matter building up over time, and we can find all sorts of insects taking advantage of that food source, from ants to cockroaches. Really important to keep those drains cleaned. And often our food service staff are responsible for cleaning the kitchen, but they don't have the tools or the training to do the floor drains. And so typically that falls on the maintenance staff, and it often doesn't come up as an issue until the drain gets completely clogged. So drains really need to be on a regular schedule for maintenance and cleaning. So here are some of the places that we find food debris that is often overlooked. So back in corners. So there is clearance under that shelf, and the fixture next to it is actually on wheels, but it doesn't get moved until there's a detailed cleaning done. And so we end up with food debris getting pushed back there by brooms and by mops, and then it's out of sight and feeding pests. So floor drains, we've talked about, there are all different styles of floor drains, and this one has a collection of food debris in the drain that needs to be cleaned. Trash handling areas are often out of sight and out of mind, and need to be cleaned very regularly to keep buildup from spills feeding pests. Down below, so here we have dumpsters with the lids open and plastic bags full of trash, many of them full of food trash. And so that's completely wide open to rodents who are active at night typically, and they'll be out there chewing through those bags with no problem and getting into that food resource. So if we're going to use dumpsters, we need to have tight fitting lids. We need to not overfill them so that lid can be shut. What we really want to see is a self-contained leak-proof compactor, and that can go a long way to preventing pest access to food and other garbage. So important when we talk about drains that we mention that there can be pathogens in that buildup in the drain. So we have food particles, you know, going down the drain, and some of them sticking to the surface of the drain, and insects feeding on them, but also microbes feeding on them. And we found things like Listeria growing on that organic muck in the drain. So when we clean those out, we want to make sure we do that before the food preparation surfaces get cleaned and after all the food's been put away. So the food gets put away, drain gets cleaned, and then those food preparation surfaces get cleaned so that we clean up any pathogens that might have been released during that drain cleaning. What I like to do is use a scraper to carefully scrape off that buildup and to have something down in the drain that I can catch that buildup so it doesn't clog that drain. And then once that drain is clean, then you can do a monthly maintenance with an enzyme or biological cleaner to keep it clean and avoid that buildup and that time-consuming cleaning process. So really important that we also clean our own equipment, including cleaning tools. So our cleaning tools are going to be full of potential pest food, and so they need to be washed and cleaned after they've been used during the day. And then they should be hung up to dry. The mopped head should be hung up to dry so that you're not growing mold on a moist mop head that may have food debris in there and providing a substrate for mold. Talked about dumpsters. Placement of dumpsters is also important. So here this dumpster is very close to an entry door. And what you end up there is stinging insects and flies that are attracted to that dumpster then hang around the dumpster area and are more likely to enter that door. What we want to see, if we're going to use a dumpster, put it 50 feet away from the building entrance. So when we talk about rodents, and we've seen some rodent droppings in this presentation, hopefully you're not seeing them where you work. But much like drains, it's really important to clean up after rodents properly. There's viruses associated with those droppings, including hantavirus, which is fatal about a third of the time. And often it's misdiagnosed until it's too late. And it's especially common in our Western states, but we do have it in the East as well. There was a case reported in Michigan in the last month. And that's a virus that hangs out on the dropping. If you're sweeping up droppings, you're potentially launching those viral particles into the air. And so what we want to do is use a careful process where we're sanitizing and disinfecting that rodent debris and droppings before we clean it up. So once again, there I'm using a scraper to scrape up those droppings and put it right into a plastic bag. But CDC has a great website for explaining how to clean up after rodents safely. So you can also be great educators and explain to your partners, your team members in your facility about how they can help avoid pest problems. And you can do that in a really friendly way. And often what I'll say is, hey, you know, this might help you at home as well. You know, if you understand that pests need food, water, and shelter, and we work really hard in our facility to avoid providing those to pests. And I just saw this basket of whatever, and pests can feed on that. So it'd be great if you could keep that in mind going forward. And anything that pests might feed on, if it's going to be stored, should be stored in a pest-proof container, like a Tupperware with a tight-fitting lid. So here's just a review. We've talked about pests needing food, water, and shelter. Here are the many areas on the left that can provide those to pests, and where we often focus our inspections when we're reviewing a facility, and then some of the strategies that go along with that. So removing trash every day at the end of the day can prevent things like fruit flies, which can develop. So you have a fly that gets into the facility, female fly, it's mated, it lays its eggs in a banana, for example. That banana goes into the trash. Overnight, you can have maggots developing into flies from that banana, and you reduce the chance of that happening if you remove the trash daily and at the end of the day, so you're not leaving food around for rodents, for example, which are active at night. You know, using screens on vent doors and windows, using drain baskets and floor drains, cleaning up, fixing things promptly, sealing cracks and crevices, you know, understanding that mice and rats can get through holes that small. And certainly you think about cockroaches and ants can squeeze through even tinier holes. So doing sealing to avoid those cracks and crevices, particularly in those vulnerable areas, is really important. And then removing things like paper and cardboard boxes, which can harbor pests. Cockroaches like to eat the glue on cardboard boxes, and they like to deposit their eggs in the corrugations in the boxes. So get those things out for recycling at the end of each day. So here's some resources for you to consider. We have training for facility managers and those working in facilities online, and you can earn a certificate for your personnel file. We have a certification program called Green Shield Certified. We'll come in and do an evaluation and troubleshoot problems, give you a comprehensive report, and can certify your facility if you meet the Green Shield standards. And then here's a great guide if you're considering any construction or renovation about putting in design features to prevent pests. So for example, how can we avoid providing roosting areas for pigeons and other birds right at the beginning as we're thinking about features that we're going to put onto this building? Please sign up for our newsletter. You can email Ruth Berlin at this address. You can also find a number of resources at this website. And certainly contact us if you're in the Maryland area about our pro bono services, which include what I mentioned in terms of doing a walkthrough, generating a report, doing quarterly reviews of your contractor's performance, and helping you with problems as they come up. So I want to acknowledge my organization, IPM Institute of North America, and University of Arizona, and professionals from those organizations were responsible for putting the content together. And then our school IPM 2020 group, which also provided content and review of some of the materials you saw today, and then funding from the North Central IPM Center and US EPA, which supported the development of this content. And please contact me if you have issues, certainly outside of the Maryland area. Myself and our organization can help you with any issues you're having with pests in your healthcare facility. So thank you so much for your attention, and we really appreciate your participation.